Okay, so let's get started. It is the last lecture related to exam number four. Exam four will be on Thursday. It'll cover chapters 11, 12, 13, and 14. We've already seen 11 and 12 and by far most of 13. Today I'll be going over a little bit over the autonomic nervous system, and I'll also be reviewing those six or eight slides or so that we skipped over related to the brain just before we jumped to cranial nerves last week. I'd like to start off by reminding you that the vocabulary goes through 72, through plasia, and we did finish up the vocabulary last time we were together. And as we were finishing up last time, I jumped into a quick rundown through the cranial nerves. I hope you've had a chance to look at that little worksheet on Blackboard that will help you practice with the cranial nerves. And either way, I will spend a few minutes here reviewing the cranial nerves with you. So, before we get started, is there anything to do with the structure of a neuron? Anything to do with the spinal cord? Anything to do with the brain that we've learned thus far that I can review or clarify for you before we move forward?
I have a question as far as with the exam coming up. How well do we need to know the cranial nerves? Like, do we have to be able to spell them?
Let me talk to you about the cranial nerves. So the question is, how well do you need to know the cranial nerves? In a moment, I'll help you with that. So hold on to that thought, and okay. I'm definitely going to answer it in just a moment. Yes, ma'am.
I just have a question about the spinal cord, the gray matter.
Yes. The posterior horn will always reach toward and touch the back. So if you're looking at, for your orientation, you're looking at the gray butterfly, the posterior horn will always be pointing toward the spinous process, pointing toward the back. The anterior horn will not reach the front. Does that make sense? So you can always get your bearings that way. Okay, let's take a, yeah, question. What do we need to know about the corpus callosum?
Yeah.
The corpus callosum is a band of axons. It's a thick band of white matter, and it connects the left to the right hemisphere.
Okay.
So whereas the two hemispheres are greatly separated by that deep longitudinal fissure, the two hemispheres do communicate one to another through the corpus callosum. So it's really the connector between the two halves of the brain.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else? Let's not worry about that yet.
Okay.
No, let's not worry about where things... Now, the word for crossing over is decussate, right? But where those pathways, where those neurons decussate, let's not worry about in this class at all.
Okay.
So let's think about the cranial nerves. This is toward the very, very end of this chapter on the brain. And how are you going to remember your cranial nerves? We're at the very, very end of this. There were a couple of mnemonics that you can use to memorize. And the first letter of these sentences is referring to the first letter of the name of the nerve. So you can remember this one: on old Olympus's towering top, a finely vested German viewed a hawk. Or maybe Oscar's old ostrich tasted tomatoes and felt very good, vomited, and how. Doesn't matter which one of these you memorize. Grab the one that maybe you can remember. If you already know your cranial nerves, you don't need to remember this, but this may help you remember the name of the nerves. And then the second mnemonic is to help you remember, is that nerve a sensory nerve, a motor nerve, or both? And so some say Marilyn Monroe, but my brother says Bridget Bardot, mm-mm. Or some say Mary Money, but my brother says big boats matter more. Any of those phrases, you know, you can just use as a way of remembering if it's a sensory nerve, a motor nerve, or both. So with that in mind, let's just run through the cranial nerves once again. And as I'm going through this, what you need to be thinking about is what's the number? We'll go through these 1 through 12. What's the name of that nerve? What does that nerve do? And finally, is it a motor nerve, a sensory nerve, or both? And if you know what it does, you know if it's sensory, motor, or both. So let's go through this. So number one is the olfactory nerve. What does it do?
Senses
smell. So it's only a sensory nerve. It has nothing to do with any movement anywhere in your body. Number two, optic nerve. It's coming out of the back of the eye. It's responsible for the sensation of vision, just the sense of vision. So seeing shadows, seeing motion, seeing light, all of that's related to your optic nerve. There are three nerves that move the eye in particular ways. Those three nerves that move the eye in a particular direction are nerves 3, oculomotor, 4, trochlear, and 6, abducens. These numbers don't go in order, right? So 3, 4, and 6 all move the eye in a particular way. Let's go back to 3, oculomotor. That tells you oculomotor. It's a motor nerve. It moves the eye in what particular way? Up and down. So blinking, looking up and down. It also allows you to look cross-eyed. And one more thing on that list, it says pupil constriction, and that'll be important when we get a little further in the lecture today. So the ability to close down your pupil is also the third nerve. Those are motor functions, right? We're doing something. Number 4 is the trochlear nerve. What does trochlea mean? We saw on the end of the humerus, the trochlea, right? And we saw the trochlear notch in the ulna. Trochlea means pulley. Okay, so imagine at the end of the humerus, you had a little rope going over a pulley through that trochlear region. What does the trochlear nerve do? It moves the eye down and out. In order for that to do it, if you look at the little picture, and I'm not going to ask you to know the anatomy of this, but you'll see there's a little pulley. That muscle goes up and through a little pulley, and that pulley action is what allows the eye to look down at that strange angle. So the trochlear nerve moves the eye down at a weird angle. If you were standing in anatomic position, you could look down at your palm, right? Down and out. That movement, trochlear nerve. Number 6, the abducens. Also a motor nerve just moving the eye. And it does so, think abducens, think abduct, moving away from the center. So this is your eye moving and looking to the periphery. Okay. So those three nerves, 3, 4, and 6, oculomotor, trochlear, and abducens, are moving your eye, and they're all motor nerves. Let's go back to number 5. That name is the trigeminal. 3 of something, trigeminal. There's 3 regions of your face that you can feel. If you can feel your forehead, feel your maxillary region, and feel your mandible, then all 3 parts of your trigeminal nerve are working in their sensation part. But this nerve also allows you to chew. So your masseter and the muscles of chewing are involved with this. So that means that this is your first nerve that is mixed, or both. It is both sensory and motor. Has a movement issue and has a sensory portion. Number 7. We saw number 7 in the lab. It is the vestibular cochlear nerve. It's the one that carries what kind of information? Hearing from the cochlea, but also balance from the semicircular canals. That is sensing only. It's a sensory nerve. We saw it in the ear. Did I just hit 7?
Yeah.
Back up. I do so apologize. 7 is the facial nerve. My bad. I saw some people giving me funny faces. They were using their facial nerve, weren't they? Right? So the facial nerve allows you to do what? Make funny faces at me, right? So Mac, you're crazy. So the 7th nerve, the facial nerve, goes to your orbicularis oris, goes to your orbicularis oculi, goes to the muscles of your face, so you can make funny Halloween faces. It also, though, that's motor, it's also sensory, and that allows you to taste on the front 2/3 of your tongue. So it's sensory, taste, it's motor, movement of your facial muscles, and if you're eating and tasting, you better be salivating, so it also gives you saliva. Now we get to 8, right? 8 is the vestibular cochlear. Some books just call it the auditory nerve. And this is the one, I apologize, that is picking up just sensory information from the semicircular canals and from the cochlea. Sensory only. We've seen it in the ear. There we go. That makes more sense. Number 9. Glossopharyngeal. When you hear that word, think glosso, tongue, pharynx, throat, back of the throat. This is the nerve. It's mixed. Nerve is both. It's going to allow you to taste on the back third of your tongue. It's also going to be your gag reflex. So that's motor. That's muscle. So gag reflex and tasting in the back of your tongue and some saliva and some salivary glands. 10. Vagus. Vagus means to wander. This is the longest nerve. It wanders all the way from your head all the way down to your bladder, your stomach, your intestines, your heart, your lungs. It goes down to all of your viscera, and it's sensing what's going on down there. So it's a sensory nerve. This is your brain freeze nerve, like I mentioned. When you drink a Slurpee too fast, you're actually affecting those nerve endings in your stomach, and you're sensing it in your head. But this is also a motor nerve in that it controls your ability to speak. So your voice box, your ability to speak or shout or whatever the paragraph said, but any kind of speaking is going to be the 10th nerve. So talking and sensing of the viscera. Number 11, accessory. This one goes down to skeletal muscles that you already know. It goes down to the trapezius and to the sternocleidomastoid. So this nerve controls the ability for you to turn your head and to shrug your shoulders, trapezius and sternocleidomastoid. It's motor only. And then number 12 is heading to your tongue, hypoglossal, and all it does is allow you to move your tongue. It's motor movement of your tongue. It seems like a lot. It's really kind of cool stuff. It's going to take you a little while, maybe some flashcards if you haven't already started that, or at least go through that paragraph that I gave you, that long word paragraph, and start plugging in everything. And the way that's going to work, the way you can be tested on this, is I will give you a paragraph, and it will say, they heard something. Well, to hearing is what nerve? Eight. It's going to be multiple choice. So I'm going to have a word bank, 1 through 12. And so if it's hearing, and that's question number one, then you're going to plug in number eight. Okay? He blinked. He looked up and down. Three, ocular motor. He tasted something on the front of his tongue. Facial, seven. Front of the tongue is seven. Tasted something in the back of the tongue. 9, glossopharyngeal, back of the throat and tongue. His stomach was upset. Vagus. His heart was beating fast. Same thing, vagus. He looked at his nose. Going down to your nose, that's also ocular motor, right? He saw something, number 2. He smelled something. Number 1. He shrugged his shoulders. 11. He stuck out his tongue. 12. He felt something on the side of his face. 7. Remember those three regions of the face? Trigeminal. 5. Okay, you with me? That's how I'm going to quiz you. It's very practical, if you will, in that, you know, this, you just have to know what these different things are, which nerve is responsible for that sensation or for that movement. Okay, multiple choice, not to spell them out, just recognize 1 through 12, which nerve is doing what. Okay, does that make sense? Anything to clarify in the cranial nerve story? Yes, ma'am.
So
do you have to, no, well, it won't say to you, there might be a question that says all the following nerves are motor or all the following nerves are sensory except. There could be a question like that. So again, if you can just run through these two mnemonics in your head, naming them 1 through 12, and know if they're sensory, motor, or both, that'll clarify most everything really, really quick. Okay, question.
Well, we need to know them by number, by name, or by both.
Both. Okay. But again, if you know the mnemonic, they kind of name themselves in a way, okay? So it is not going to be fill in the blank. It's going to be recognition, matching kind of thing. So you don't have to worry about spelling them out or anything like that. Anything else to clarify on the cranial nerves or anything on the brain, spinal cord, or neuron thus far? You're looking really concerned, or you're memorizing behind my head? Okay. So let me go back to where we dropped off, and I'm going to go back before the cranial nerves. Again, on the cranial nerves, I'm not going to ask you any of the anatomy here. I'll never see any of these pictures. They were just there to help you maybe get a better appreciation of what these cranial nerves are doing. And I'm heading back to just before, I believe, am I correct, that we finished up with this little conversation with the PET scan? Did we do this? And we talked about how in this PET scan, the person was on the left hand, was listening to instructions, and that part of the brain that's lit up is what area? That's Wernicke's area, where we're perceiving the sound, understanding the instructions, and then this guy is going to start talking. And as he talks, what do we see lit up? Broca's area, along with a stretch going upward that would correspond to portion of the motor strip, right? That precentral gyrus or the motor strip. And if we think about that motor strip and that guy who stretched out around that section of the brain, you saw that a large part of the motor strip was dedicated to the face and to swallowing and to vocalization. Did we finish that together on Thursday? Okay. And then I don't think I got much into this idea of cerebral lateralization. The idea is that your right brain and your left brain are not identical. And if you are right-handed, which most of us are, that means that the dominant hemisphere for you is your left hemisphere, right? It crosses over. If you are left-handed, your dominant hemisphere is your right hemisphere. Okay, do we understand that? Okay. And this idea of handedness or this idea of lateralization, there are entire journals and books written on this. Now, as I've said to you, certain functions are more on one side or the other. When you look at the brain and you see Wernicke's area or Broca's area, every time I showed those to you, they're on the left side of the brain. That's for 95%+ of the people in the world. But there are some people out there, they're just, their brain's different, and their Wernicke's and their Broca's area would be over instead on the right side. And they're going to have a little bit of a different lateralization scheme going on. As long as their brain's intact, you wouldn't know the difference, right? But if you were going to do some neurological testing on them, you would realize that their brain was a little bit wired differently than most of us. Now, to even prove further that our brains are not the same, left-handed people and right-handed people have slightly different shaped brains. These asymmetries are called patellas. Don't memorize it. Just recognize that there's a little bit of difference. A right-handed person has a right frontal difference and a left occipital patella, whereas reverse it for left-handed people. Do not memorize that. Just evidence, even anatomical evidence, that left-handed individuals and right-handed individuals truly are wired a little bit differently. Now, the two sides of the brain. There is the left hemisphere. This is referred to as your categorical hemisphere. This is where we saw Wernicke's area. This is where we see down here, it says motor speech area. This is the Broca's area. Okay, let me just write that out. So the motor speech area is the Broca's area. And this is also where your analytical, your math and science centers of your brain are actually on the left hemisphere. This is also, again, like it says in the bottom, this is your speech dominant hemisphere for most individuals. Whereas, if your right hemisphere is considered the representational hemisphere. This is where your imagination is. This is where your ability to perceive the world is. This is your musical and your artistic skills, some of your greater abilities to recognize patterns and spatial relationships are centered over in the right hemisphere. Now remember, as we've already discussed today, that the corpus callosum is connecting the two hemispheres. And so as long as your brain is intact and both hemispheres are connected, you've got both sides of your brain working together. But some of us do have more developed right brains versus left brains. And again, this is the idea of lateralization. That corpus callosum has hundreds of millions of axons going between the two sides of the brain. Turns out that this lateralization occurs by about first grade, kindergarten or first grade. When you look at a 12-month-old, look at a 6-month-old, and what are they grabbing? They're grabbing everything with both hands. You don't see a lot of left or right-handedness in a newborn. Even 1 year old, 2 years old, they're still pretty much grabbing with both hands. Now, you'll start seeing more of a specialization. You'll start seeing when they start writing and using a crayon, they may start using preference for one hand over the other. And by the time they get to 5 or 6 years old, it's pretty much locked in. Now, if a young child loses a limb, they have really no problem. I mean, it's traumatic, but they can very quickly sort of switch over to the other hand. And they, if they were right-handed, if you will, by birth, they lost their right hand at 18 months of age, they would develop left-handed skills and they would never know the difference and they would appear, right, to be left-handed. If an adult loses a limb, it's far more traumatic because our brain is so set into its handedness that it's much more difficult to switch over. So most of you, I'm extremely right-handed. My left hand, I really have difficulty writing with it. I'm a saxophonist and I can play very well, but when it comes to piano, again, my left hand is really just the weak link in my musical skills. So when I think about, the last thing I want to say is that women have a thicker corpus callosum. Now, this is the generalization, but most women have a thicker corpus callosum, which suggests that after a stroke, after brain injury, a woman would have an easier time in recovery. I'm not talking hugely different, but because there's a thicker corpus callosum, there's more connection between the good side and the bad side of the brain. So women have a chance of doing making up for that deficit a little bit easier, and a guy after a stroke typically has a more difficult time pulling information over from the good side. So there's a little bit of a difference in brain injury and recovery between men and women because of the thickness of the corpus. So here's your brain. Again, these are general statements. They're going to apply to 95% of us. That is that in your left brain, here is that Broca's area, motor speech area. Wernicke's area is too far down on the side to see it. But this is also where your rational thought and your language and your mathematical comprehension are housed. Whereas on the other side of your brain, this is where your musical abilities and your intuitiveness, your nonverbal thing, your ability to see shapes, all of that is on the other side. In my experience, most of the artists, architects, psychologists that I know are left-handed. Not overall, right? But there's definitely, left-handed people only account for 10, 15, maybe 20% of the population at the most. And it seems like a lot of my friends who are in those particular fields, sort of more of the artistic, artsy, psycho kind of fields, they're more left-handed. More concentrated left-handed people in those fields. You may have similar experiences, or you may argue that, nope, everyone I know who's an architect is right-handed. I don't know anyone who's different. But anyway, just think about that. Maybe think about your own family members, and maybe they exhibit some different strengths along with their handedness. So what did we learn so far? In the brain, all of our higher cognitive functions or all of our higher order processes are housed up in our cerebrum, right? More specifically up in our cortex. So if we're going to be conscious of something, that information must have reached up through our brainstem and into our cerebrum. Things that we're not in control of, our involuntary part of our brain, is down in the pons, and the medulla, and the brainstem, and the cerebellum. So when I talk about higher order processes, our higher language skills, our, as humans, our higher cognition skills, our higher memory, emotion, and consciousness, all of that is where? Up in our cerebrum, right? Because remember, even a cockroach has a brainstem. There's just a couple of structures I want you to know. You've already seen these in the lab. They may not have struck a chord with you yet. There are the brain ventricles. These are fluid-filled spaces, cavities within your brain. There are four of them in your brain. There are two that are the lateral ventricles. They're just on the side, as the name suggests. There's two of them, left and right. Easy enough. There's a third ventricle. Whoever named these wasn't very inventive, but maybe that makes it easier. The third ventricle is in the diencephalon. When I say diencephalon, I hope you're thinking that's the pit, the nugget, the core, the very center of my brain. And then there's a fourth ventricle, which lies down between the pons and the cerebellum. Okay, these four fluid-filled regions. Let me quiz you on that. What's in these ventricles? Cerebrospinal fluid, right? It's the same fluid that's around your spinal cord that fits around your brain is also inside your brain. And what cells make that CSF? Ependymal cells. Good. Remember, the ependymal cells are lining all the fluid-filled regions of your central nervous system. They are one of the glial cells we discussed in the first day of the nervous system. This fluid is, for the brain, providing buoyancy and a protective layer and some stability for the brain. Cross off the word choroid plexus. I'm just not going to deal with it at all this semester. And this CSF is very, very similar to plasma. We'll be talking about plasma next week. Plasma is the liquidy portion of your blood. And essentially, the CSF and the plasma are very similar in their makeup. And as it says down there, remember that this CSF is made by the ependymal cells. Here, I've got two pictures of the ventricles. Yes?
What did you say made the cerebral
spinal? Ependymal cells. And it's on that slide, the one I just passed over. It's down there toward the bottom, second to the bottom bullet, ependymal cells. Okay. Now, here's a picture of the ventricles. From the lateral view on the left, you see this big lateral ventricle. You can't see the one behind it. So there's one ventricle here, other ones deep to it. The third ventricle is right in the center. Diencephalon, the pit, the core of the brain, goes around the thalamus area. And the fourth one down here in the pons cerebellar area. Notice that there's a little duct that connects all of the ventricles one to another. Those are called the aqueducts. The Romans had aqueducts. They carried water from one city to the next. Same idea. The aqueducts are tubes, and they're going to carry the CSF from one ventricle to the other. And notice, too, that the fourth ventricle is continuous with the central canal of the spinal cord. So this fluid is continuous, right? It's everywhere. If someone has meningitis and they have an infection of their meninges or of the cerebrospinal fluid, right, we're going to test for it at the spinal cord, but the devastating effects of meningitis are in the brain. You've got the CSF floating around, right, your subarachnoid space. You also have the CSF in your ventricles. If you're having inflammation of your brain, and that inflammation is from infection of this fluid, you're not only you're pushing in from the subarachnoid space around the brain, and you're pushing out from the ventricles, you're basically squeezing this kind of jelly-like brain, and that means death, right? Too much pressure on the brain. So you can imagine now that this fluid is, you know, circulating everywhere around. On the frontal view on the right, it looks like two ram's horns, right? Kind of two ram horn-looking structures, some sort of football helmet-looking thing. So you've got your two lateral ventricles. There's your third ventricle shown in that angle, and your fourth ventricle shown here down by the pons and the cerebellum. I have another picture of it. It's the same thing. I think just nicer colors, but it's the same idea. Okay, can everyone see their four ventricles now? Two laterals, left and right. The third in the diencephalon, the fourth down by the pons and the cerebellum, all contiguous, all sharing the same fluid circulating around. There's another feature about the brain, and that's the blood-brain barrier. We also discussed this in the first day, and that is that the brain has an extra level of protection. And what cells help maintain the blood-brain barrier? Astrocytes, right? The astrocytes were another one of the glial cells found within the CNS. Now, this blood-brain barrier is going to strongly restrict the molecules that can get out of our bloodstream and into the circulation of the brain tissue. This is a good thing, right? It means that toxins or bacteria or viruses that might be floating in our body would not be able to penetrate into the brain. The blood-brain barrier, though, becomes a problem when you're trying to treat a brain disorder. So from a pharmacological standpoint, if you're trying to treat a brain tumor, You can't assume that a drug given intravenously to a patient is going to make it past the blood-brain barrier and be effective in the brain as a chemo agent. It also creates a barrier for some depression meds. I mean, everything we give a person is not necessarily going to make it through or past the blood-brain barrier. So there's some extra special, you know, considerations for pharmacological agents when treating brain injuries or brain disorders. So this next slide, I think we've already talked about. We've got those astrocytes. We've seen them, those green star-shaped looking cells in the cartoons. And they're going to be plugging up all of the openings in the capillaries. Now, there's two places. It says three. Go ahead and cross off, once again, choroid plexus. I'll be consistent. I didn't talk about it. I'm not going to talk about the choroid plexus. But the other two places, the hypothalamus and the pineal gland. These are two places where the blood-brain barrier is a little bit less strict, or the BBB is reduced. Why do you think the hypothalamus and the pineal gland would be a place where there is little or less blood-brain barrier? When you hear those two words together, hypothalamus and pineal gland, they're both in the brain, and they're both connected in that they are both what? What system besides the nervous system are they both involved with?
Endocrine.
They're both releasing hormones, right? So these are two brain areas or glands that release hormones into your bloodstream. Well, it's just like a gate. If I'm releasing hormones and the gate is open into the bloodstream to release those hormones, wherever the gate's open, something can crawl in, right? So because there's a breakdown, there's less security at the gate. So where the hormones are being released, that's also an opportunity for bacteria or viruses to enter into the brain, and that's where the breakdown of the blood-brain barrier can often occur. Does that make sense? Right. So the pineal gland, the hypothalamus are both hormone-secreting glands. They're releasing substances into the blood, and because the gate, I think of it, the gate is open, things can come in the gate when it's open. Here's that little picture that we saw long ago of an astrocyte. It's that star-shaped cell, kind of large, and you see its little arm-like structures reaching around and plugging up all the little spaces in the capillary, maintaining the blood-brain barrier. Every chapter or every system, we try to finish up with discussing what happens to that system as we get older. Well, the nervous system starts showing signs of decay about age 30. Boy, that's depressing. Especially when you consider, when did I say your brain was finally put together? 25, right? We've only got 5 good years, right? So by 25, you're put together. By 30, you're falling apart. Okay, that may sound familiar in other ways, too. I don't know. So at age 30, what happens? We start having a decrease in the ability to maintain homeostasis of your brain. That is, there are fewer neurons. Right? We start losing neurons. We start losing gray matter, cell bodies. We start losing size and weight to the brain. We start decreasing the ability to remove waste products. There are fewer synapses, less blood flow, and overall less cognition. It's a very slow progress, but things start to change by about age 30. About the only thing that increases is the garbage, right? So the lipids and the plaque and the crap of the brain starts to accumulate, and we know that these lipids and atherosclerotic plaque are the stuff that, in part, builds up in Alzheimer's to an excessive amount. Let's take a look at a picture of a brain. The top represents a normal elderly brain about age 80, and it's all blue. This is kind of a PET scan kind of image. And blue tells us, if you look at the scale, that less than 2% of the brain matter has been lost. So that's normal, right? So when I said the brain starts decaying at age 80, I'm not suggesting that by age 80 it has to be in any distress, but there is a decrease. On the bottom is a computer-enhanced image of collective Alzheimer's patients. And what you see is that some parts of the brain are still blue, suggesting normal, but there are these hot spots of hot pink. where as much as 30% of the cell bodies of the gray matter has been destroyed. And you'll look, it's kind of random. And now you know enough about the brain to know that different parts of the brain, if affected, would have different symptoms. And patients with Alzheimer's sometimes have very different initial symptoms. What they have issues with can be different as you look at different Alzheimer's patients because of what part of the brain has been most damaged at that time. It used to be thought that Alzheimer's was sort of a default setting, that because we were living past cancer and past heart disease and as a society we were living longer, that Alzheimer's was simply the outcome of normal aging. That would have been the norm. You would have heard that 10, 15 years ago or before that. Now we're changing the tune a little bit, and we're saying, you know, Alzheimer's is a disease. It is not normal to have this extent of a disease state. Yes, it's normal for some forgetfulness and for some loss of neurons and maybe, you know, some normal dementia, normal stuff, but not to the extent that occurs with Alzheimer's. So now we're looking for the cause. We're trying to figure out what really is the trigger and the cause for Alzheimer's disease. We know that there are some forms that are very genetic. They run in families and hit very, very early, in the late 40s and 50s even. That's a really rare kind of Alzheimer's, but it does happen. And much of other Alzheimer's seems to be something environmental. We're not quite sure what it is, but something is causing that, and we're hoping that someday we can learn how to avoid it or decrease the incidence of it. So that finishes up brain. We're back to the cranial nerves and those things that we've already talked about. You now have 85% of the exam. I mean, the autonomic nervous system, what I'm about to share with you, is not a major part of the exam. I'll tell you how to prepare for this next little part. But hopefully you've been looking at this material over the weekend, and you're feeling rather confident on parts of the neuron and parts of the spinal cord and most of the brain story, and you're on your way to mastering the cranial nerves. Anything in that conversation to discuss? I will tell you as well, this is the longest exam, the one that's coming up on Thursday. This is the longest exam of the year. I think there's about 150 questions. Most of our exams have been closer to 100. So it is the kind of exam where you just have to know your stuff well, and you just kind of march through it as quickly as possible. And it is likely that some of you won't finish it. And I will hold the gate to an hour and a half. So an hour and a half will be time to turn in your exams, and then I'll make any adjustments to the score if necessary. And I'll tell you why I do that later in the course, but just be prepared. You may not all finish the exam. So if you know you're a little bit of a person who spends a lot of time on questions, you want to just kind of tell yourself to speed it up a little bit and move through this exam so that you don't run out of time. Anything on the brain? Okay. Let's move on to our last chapter. I'll tell you right now, we're only going to get through slide 28. And if I remember right, this is chapter 14. And if I remember right, it's 28. Let me see if I'm right. 26. We're only going to get to slide 26. 26 is at the bottom of page 209. We are not going to continue on to the slide that says white rami, right? So I know where we're going to get, and we're going to stop the conversation. We're not going to go white rami or on. So we'll stop at slide 26. So the autonomic nervous system. This is your fight or flight response. I alluded to it at the beginning of the nervous system. We were talking about the four different divisions of the nervous system, and under the autonomic motor, I said, you know what, there's two more divisions under there. There's the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system that we would be discussing, and here we are. As we're going through this little section, I want you to be comparing and contrasting. This really is going to be a compare and contrast. How is sympathetic different from parasympathetic? And I'll help you with that. Now, the autonomic nervous system is the part of your nervous system governing all of your involuntary actions. It is the movement of your smooth muscle. It is the movement of your heart. And it is the secretion of glands. These are all activities over which you have no control. right? So this is all the involuntary responses of your body. Now, it is going to be working with your somatic nervous system. When you see somatic nervous system, think somatic motor or voluntary nervous system. So these things are working in concert. They're working together. But we can tease them out. When you hear autonomic nervous system, the thing that first comes to mind probably is fight or flight. And that is a part of it. And during that fight or flight state, your body is in a state of heightened readiness. It's ready to run or to fight. And that's the sympathetic side. We're going to be talking about it in comparison to the parasympathetic as well. Tell me, though, what happens? The scenario I always imagine is you're out camping. It's a beautiful, starlit evening. And suddenly, right behind the campground, you hear a twig snap. A loud twig, right? What happens? You freeze, maybe, right? And what else happens? Heart rate goes up fast, right? It happens. This all happens really, really fast. Heart rate goes up. What else happens?
Pupils dilate.
Pupils will go, whoop, dilate. Respiration rate up. Blood pressure up. Hair on the back of your neck and all of your body up, right? Those little erector muscles will pull the hair on your body like a porcupine. I'm ready to fight. I'm not sure what that's all about, right? But certainly think of a porcupine. We're ready to dart. What happens to the skin color?
Pale.
You become more pale, don't you? And why is that? Yeah, so you've only got about 5 liters or so of blood, and your body has to make a choice. It has to decide, you know what, I've got 5 liters of blood, and I need some of that blood to go internally to my muscles to run. So I'm going to take the blood away from my skin and bring it to my muscles in order to fight or flight. And as a result, my skin's going to become more pale. I'm going to lose some skin coloring. I'm going to become more pale. And your mouth goes dry, right? So you're about to speak publicly or you're scared, and you'll sense that your mouth goes very, very dry. So those are the things that we know. We know this. We know this is what happens, right, when we're scared. These are everyday experiences. We may be throwing some new vocabulary on this, but you've got the everyday common sense experience of fight or flight. So I need to be careful with my abbreviations here. SNS here is somatic nervous system. ANS is the autonomic nervous system. Remember, the somatic nervous system is your voluntary conscious control. The SNS would therefore be running your skeletal muscle, right? Your voluntary muscle. Your autonomic nervous system is your involuntary. So this is going to be smooth muscle. This is going to be heart, cardiac muscle. This is going to be running your digestive processes, your respiration, all of those things over which we don't have direct control. So again, I'm comparing here the autonomic nervous system, this new thing we're learning about, with the somatic nervous system, which we've been talking about, right? The somatic nervous system is what we were talking about when we're talking about skeletal muscles and movement of things. So the somatic nervous system, SNS, uses both incoming somatic sensory. When I say somatic sensory, what does that mean? Remember, there's 4 parts to your nervous system: somatic sensory, visceral sensory, somatic motor, and autonomic motor, right? Those 4 parts. So somatic sensory neurons are what? The ones bringing information from your skin and from your special senses to your spinal cord or brain, right? That's your somatic sensory. Your somatic motor neurons are the ones that send motor instruction out to your skeletal muscle, right? That's your somatic side. That's your voluntary side. Remember, your somatic motor neurons go down to innervate your skeletal muscles. This is the same story we've been talking about. How is the autonomic nervous system different? Well, it's going to use both sensory and motor neurons as well, but this is the stuff over which you don't have any control. So now you're going to be using those visceral sensory neurons. Remember, there are neurons sending signals in from your gut, from your brain, from your kidneys, from your heart. All of your organs right now are sending signals in. visceral, right? Visceral sensory. How is my stomach doing? How's my bladder doing? Is my heart beating too fast? Is my respiration rate up? All that is being told to your brain all the time. And then there are visceral, or there are autonomic motor neurons that are going to send instructions back to your lung, back to your heart, back to your stomach, back to your glands, telling them how to do their job. Let's take a look at the wiring of this. This is one of the significant differences between the voluntary nervous system and the autonomic nervous system. On the left is what we've been looking at all along. We've got over here a skin receptor. Something's happening in the skin, and that signal is going to travel from the skin. It's going to go up into a spinal nerve. Let's just think about this. Each section of your body is divided up into skin segments. What do we call those segments of your body that receive sensation? Remember the word dermatome, right? So you've got these strips of your body that are divided up into these dermatomes. So who knows where this is, but this is some little section of your skin. It's sending in a signal to the spinal nerve that is responsible for that section of your body's sensations. It's going to go into the spinal cord. It's going to travel up the posterior root. We're going to pass right through that posterior root ganglion. And what do we find in that posterior root ganglion? That ganglion is a cluster of cell bodies, right? So that's your sensory neuron, cell body. And what shape is that cell body? Unipolar, right? This is unipolar sensory neuron clustered in the ganglion. That signal continues up into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. Now there, what would the story be? Normally you would say, oh, now it's going to talk to some interneurons, right? And the interneurons are then going to send it out the motor side and have an effect. Yes, that's true. But before that happens, what has to happen here? This is voluntary. This is not a reflex. This is not something that's happening outside of your control. So if you are going to choose to move your arm, what's missing from this picture is that now there would be a neuron going up your spinal cord as part of an ascending tract. It would be going up and going where in your brain? Going to be going up and being received by the sensory strip. Yes, going up, received by the parietal lobe and the sensory strip. Then the sensory strip talks to the motor strip right next door in the frontal lobe, sends a signal down, a descending tract, down the spinal cord. And then that neuron then will speak to this outgoing motor neuron, which then goes to your arm and says, bend. Okay, to flex the arm. So that's what's missing, right? It's missing in every one of our pictures. Don't forget that if we're dealing with skeletal muscle, the brain had to tell it to move, unless what? Unless we're dealing with a reflex. When you're dealing with a reflex, we forget about the brain power, right? The spinal cord does it for us. But typically, we have to wait for the signal to go up to the sensory strip, come down from the motor strip, and tell our body to move. That's what we've been doing all along on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, let's see how the autonomic nervous system is just slightly different, and it's different in its wiring. Here, we're talking about all the things over which we don't have control. It's your visceral responses. So there's a sensory neuron down on the lung, right? It's a visceral sensory neuron. It is sending signals to your spinal cord about how your lungs are doing. Same old story. We come in the posterior root. There's our little, you know, cell body for the sensory neuron. Nothing's different. We come in, again, this is going to be automatic things, isn't it? Is it going to go all the way to my sensory strip, up my brain, up my spinal cord to my sensory strip? If it reaches my sensory strip, it's reached my consciousness, hasn't it? Except in the cortex. So these things are going to go up the spinal cord only as far as the medulla oblongata, as far as the pons, as far as the brainstem, as far as the cerebellum. The unconscious part of your brain is going to be controlling your visceral responses. It's your brainstem that's going to control your autonomic motor functions. So the signal goes up only to your brainstem and then comes back down, right? A descending track from your brainstem. And what does it do? Now it sends a signal out from the spinal cord, goes out the anterior root. Nothing is different yet. Here's where the difference is. That neuron only goes as far as a ganglion. And then it communicates with a second neuron, which then goes down to the effector, in this case, the lung. So what's different here is that rather than one neuron, right, over here, I've got one neuron that goes all the way from the spinal cord to the effector. In the autonomic nervous system, I've got one neuron. It only goes as far as the ganglion, and then a second neuron that travels down. So I've got two neurons in series. The first neuron is called the preganglionic neuron. The second neuron is called the postganglionic neuron. Okay, and it's all labeled on here for you, the pre and the postganglionic neuron. Now let me help you with this. This ganglion is not the same as this ganglion, right? This ganglion up top, that's the one we've been talking about and loving and dreaming about the last couple of days. That's the dorsal root or the posterior root ganglion. That's where your cell bodies are for your sensory neurons. This ganglion, with the two arrows, that ganglion is a sympathetic ganglion. I showed it to you in passing a couple of lectures ago. And let me go back to where that image was. I told you I'd go back to this. We're going back to the spinal cord presentation. And remember this slide. It was the first slide where we saw the spinal cord inside the vertebra along with some back muscles. And we were talking about how the spinal nerve splits into the rami, the posterior, and the anterior ramus. And I said to you, we'll come back to this little teardrop or ear ring later on. That is the sympathetic ganglion. That's the ganglion I'm talking about when I'm referring to the sympathetic nervous system. Okay, so you've seen it before. It just got glossed over. These are your sympathetic. The other word for the sympathetic ganglion, and you're going to see this over and over, is paravertebral. What would that mean? Para, next to, right? So paravertebral means next to the vertebra. And that's exactly where these sympathetic ganglia are. Okay, paravertebral. That was back in the conversation near the dermatomes and back by spinal cord injury in the spinal cord chapter. So we look at this wiring, we realize that there's a difference in the wiring of the autonomic system. Let's take a look at maybe a different way of thinking about this. This table is really nice. This table is going to flash through the differences between the somatic nervous system and the autonomic nervous system. So let's take a look at these. And this is, I know, a little small, but you can grab this on your computer, your tablet, or on the blackboard, and pull this table up. Look at this. This is going to really, I think, help you go through the differences here. So the type of control, the somatic nervous system is your voluntary, right? Voluntary. Whereas your autonomic nervous system is your involuntary side. How many neurons are in a pathway? We saw that there's one neuron. It leaves the spinal cord and goes all the way to the effector. One neuron. Whereas in the autonomic nervous system, there were two neurons, weren't there? There was the first neuron that went only to the ganglion. So there's a preganglionic and a postganglionic neuron. Were there any ganglia associated with the motor neurons? Well, in the somatic nervous system, none, right? It's a direct connection. It goes directly from the spinal cord to the effector, whereas in the autonomic nervous system, yes, we saw that sympathetic, here's that word, paravertebral, same thing, sympathetic or paravertebral ganglion. What kind of information is being sent through your somatic nervous system? Well, it's picking up your somatic senses. Remember, that includes your proprioception and your special senses. Whereas the autonomic nervous system is picking up also your somatic senses and your visceral senses. So that's your visceral senses, right? Inside. Is there a ganglia associated with the sensory side? Absolutely. That's not different. So there's a posterior ganglion on both. What are the effector organs? What are the effector organs? Hold on. So in the somatic side, the voluntary side, what are we moving? Skeletal muscle, and that's it, right? Whereas over on the autonomic nervous side, we're controlling cardiac muscle, smooth muscle, and glands. Response to stimuli, or response to effector. When a neuron sends a signal to a skeletal muscle, it releases acetylcholine, and it tells the muscle to contract. That's all that happens. When the electrical signal goes to the muscle gets excited, and the muscle contracts. In the autonomic nervous system, we're going to see more control than that. What we're going to see is that we can either excite the tissue or we can inhibit the tissue. We can tell the heart to beat faster or we can tell the heart to beat slower. We can tell the respiration rate to go up. We can tell the respiration rate to go down. We can tell the blood vessel to get bigger or smaller. There are a lot more control on the autonomic nervous side. The only neurotransmitter we have described in this entire course thus far has been acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter used by your voluntary neurons. There's another neurotransmitter I'm going to introduce here, and you've heard of it, and that is epinephrine. Now, here it says norepinephrine. Don't get excited about that. I'm not going to differentiate that. Right now, I want you to realize that you will hear the words epinephrine, right, EpiPens, and you'll hear the word adrenaline. They're the same thing, okay? Now let's figure out why in the world these two things are the same thing. What does epi mean? On or upon. Nephro, kidney. What is on the kidney? The adrenal gland. So there was a hormone released by the adrenal gland called adrenaline, and somebody said, oh no, we should call it epinephrine. It's the same thing. And there's a norepinephrine and there's a noradrenaline that we're not going to differentiate here in this course. Okay? So when you hear about EpiPen, why does someone have to carry an EpiPen, and what does it do should they inject it in their thigh? Allergic reactions. What happens in an allergic reaction? Peanut, bee sting, what happens? But what are we worried about? The airway closing down, right? So what do we do to help that person get past that airway closure until more medical help can arrive? Get out their EpiPen, stick some epinephrine in their thigh. What happens? You're giving them adrenaline rush, right? So we're going to help close down their airway and allow paramedics or whomever to get more time to help them. But at the same time, their heart rate's going to start going up. The blood pressure is going to go up. They're going to be respiring faster. All sorts of things are going to be happening as a result of them being stabbed with epinephrine. It basically sends the body into a fight or flight response. Okay? So, I just want you to see this idea that epinephrine will be a hormone or will be a neurotransmitter that's released as a part of the autonomic nervous system, fight or flight, adrenaline. And then finally, I'll come back to this fact a little bit later on, the axons in the somatic nervous system are myelinated, thick, and fast. That makes sense to us, right? Myelin speeds up the signal, thicker neurons, thicker axons can carry more information. Over in the autonomic nervous system, we're going to see that preganglionic axons are very thin and they're myelinated, But the postganglionic axons are going to be unmyelinated. Okay, so they're going to slow things down a little bit. And we'll appreciate that a little bit as we move through. Ladies, you're bothering me way up here. I can only imagine how much you're bothering the people in front of me.
Sorry.
Thank you. Okay, so that's the comparison. So look at that table, right? What we've been talking about, voluntary versus the autonomic involuntary, and I think you'll be able to put some pieces together if they're not already falling into place. Let's take a look at this idea that the axons are a little bit different. The wiring is different in the autonomic nervous system. So we're leaving the spinal cord. What do we call this little area of the spinal cord right there? Remember those horns? And here we kind of see a bump out to the side. That would be from the lateral horn. And this is a motor neuron. And this would be the preganglionic axon, because it's only going to go to the ganglion. This is that sympathetic ganglion or the paravertebral ganglion, all the same thing. Okay? And then it's going to synapse with another ganglion. This is now the postganglionic axon, which is going to go to, in this case, the intestines, to the effector. So two neurons are involved. A little different wiring scenario. Well, let's imagine instead of the body, we're just taking a flight. And we're going from Indianapolis to Miami, but we have to change flights in Chicago. So that means that Chicago is the... No, we're starting in Indianapolis. We're going to Miami, but we have to go through Chicago. We have to change flights there. So that means that Chicago, in this kind of strange way, is the ganglion, right? It's the hub. It's the meeting place. So to get from Indianapolis to Miami, I have to go through Chicago. It's the same idea. We've got two flights we've got to take. We've got to take a flight from Indianapolis to Chicago. That'd be the preganglionic flight. And we got to take another flight from the hub down to Miami. In Miami, what's in Miami? The beach, right? But what else? This is autonomic. So autonomic signals go to things like smooth muscle, cardiac muscle, or glands, right? So we're doing autonomic motor system in Miami, right? We're going to be controlling the involuntary things. At the very, very end of chapter 11, the last slide of the introductory chapter on the nervous system, I mentioned that neurons are arranged in four basic circuitry pathways or patterns. And I told you about convergence and divergence, and there were two other ones on that slide that I told you to cross out. Remember that? So convergent, divergent. Let's take a look at the second one first. Neuronal divergence. This is one cell telling its three friends, and then those three neurons tell their three friends. This is Twitter. This is how the autonomic nervous system works. This is especially how the sympathetic nervous system works. So when the bear walks in the room and you're scared, all systems go on full alert immediately, right? There's an all points bulletin sent out to all of your body because of this divergence, right? All signals are turned on at once. Versus convergence, the top example. Convergence is when all the signals are converging onto a limited number of neurons. It's kind of the other way around. It's more of a calming effect, isn't it? There's all this information coming into a central location. So on the bottom, under neuronal divergence, make a note, used in sympathetic nervous system, right? There's definitely a lot of divergence in fight or flight responses. Okay, now, so what I've done right now is I've given you some comparisons between the somatic nervous system, the voluntary side, and the autonomic or the involuntary side. The rest of this conversation is going to be comparing and contrasting sympathetic and parasympathetic. Okay? Just comparing these two subdivisions of this automatic response. So let's take a look. Here the ANS, the autonomic nervous system, is subdivided into the two sides, parasympathetic and sympathetic. They are similar in that both are going to use the two neuron system. They're both going to use the preganglionic followed by the postganglionic neuron. And I know it doesn't say postganglionic. You can add that there just for clarity. So this should say, to be really clear, postganglionic neuron. right here. Add the word post before that. Both of these systems is going to use a ganglion, right? This hub, like Chicago. Both of these systems are involuntary. So your sympathetic and your parasympathetic divisions are both completely involuntary, out of your control. They're both involved with maintaining your homeostasis. But they do so in very different ways. The sympathetic and the parasympathetic systems are, I don't want to say completely, but nearly opposite. Okay, they are nearly opposite in what their effects are. So what the sympathetic system does, the parasympathetic, for what we're learning, essentially does the opposite. So we'll kind of think of them as being yin-yang. Okay. Now, let's talk about the parasympathetic. I haven't talked about this really at all yet. We know about the fight or flight. Everyone kind of knows fight or flight response. But the opposite of that is the parasympathetic side. You'll hear it referred to as the craniosacral division, and you'll see why in a moment. And the parasympathetic is not concerned with fight or flight, but instead with rest and digest. This is the portion that's involved with replenishing your energy or conserving your energy. After a meal, right, you get a little bit lazier. You just want to prop your feet up. Your stomach needs some time to digest that meal. This is that parasympathetic time. It does work with sympathetic nervous system to keep everything going. I don't want to ever suggest to you that we're ever completely sympathetic or completely parasympathetic. These are usually some back and forth scale of control. So one's a little bit more turned on, one's a little bit less turned on. They're kind of just keeping our balance. Now, there would be a time, right? People in military on alert, right? Who are for a very long period of time in a sympathetic mode. And that does horrible things to our body, right? But for the average person who goes home every night and enjoys a meal and sits in front of the television and comes to school and does the normal things that you do, as stressful as you think you are, you're not stressed out, right? You have this balance of sympathetic and parasympathetic moments in your day, right? Very few of us are on a full-time, high-alert, sympathetic mode. Right? Maybe the guy in the foxhole is, but that's about it. Versus the sympathetic division. This is going to be nicknamed the thoracolumbar division. You'll see why in a moment. Again, you know this. This is a side of this that's more involved with fight or flight or preparing your bodies for emergencies. It's going to turn on things, make your metabolism go higher, increase your alertness. And we know what happens, right, when we're in a fight or flight response. We talked about it. Pupils dilate, heart rate, blood pressure goes up, respiration goes up, mouth goes dry, all of those things. Now, as we continue this conversation, think about the differences here. And I'll have pictures of everything that I'm about to say. So the preganglionic neurons are housed in different places. Okay, and I know when I listen back to this presentation, I'm saying a lot of multisyllabic words that are going by really, really fast. Right? So let me say that again. The preganglionic neurons are going to come from different regions of the central nervous system. That is, the parasympathetic neurons are going to originate from two places, craniosacral. Cranial, referring to the brain stem. Sacral, down in the sacrum. So think that the parasympathetic is coming from a pair of places, P-A-I-R. And yes, that's spelled wrong. That should not be carnio, but craniosacral. Right, typo. Whereas the sympathetic nervous system is going to be originating from the spinal cord off what's called the thoracolumbar region, that is the thorax, thoracic and the lumbar regions. So let's take a look at that. And then let's make a couple of connections while we're here. So on the left-hand side, this is parasympathetic. Sympathetic over on the right. It tells us that the parasympathetic is craniosacral. That is, the neurons coming off the spinal cord are coming from the two green areas, up in the cranium and down little tiny green area at the sacrum. And then it tells us that these nerves coming off from the cranium are actually cranial nerves 3, 7, 9, and 10. Let's just kind of try to put some things together here. On the left-hand side, this is parasympathetic nervous system. What happens to your body when you're in a parasympathetic surge? You're conserving energy. Let's assume we're eating a meal, right? So when you're relaxed, tell me about the status of your pupils. When you're scared, your pupils whoop, dilate, get big. When you're relaxed, your pupils do what? Constrict. If you look back on the cranial nerve list, you will see that it's cranial nerve number 3, ocular motor, that constricts your pupil. Okay, so if you're in a parasympathetic mode, you just had a meal, you're in that rest and digest mode, and your eyes are more constricted, cranial nerve number 3 is involved with that. What about 7 and 9? 7 and 9 were both involved with what sense? Taste. Yeah, 7 was the front 2/3 of your tongue, 9 was the back 1/3 of your tongue. They're both involved with your enjoying that delicious meal you're trying to eat. And saliva, right? Making saliva and anticipating the meal and digesting the meal. And then what about 10? 10 was that long nerve that went down to your stomach, went down to your intestines, went down to your viscera, and sensed or reported back on the overall functioning of these organs. So does it make sense to you that in that rest and digest mode, that cranial nerves 3, 7, 9, and 10 have a part? They have a role in your rest and digest, in your eating, your digestion, in your stomach, and in the constriction of your pupils. Okay? I'll say that all over again. It's in words coming up in a minute if you didn't catch all that. Okay, so again, what we're going to be doing here is comparing and contrasting these two systems. The parasympathetic system is actually more simple. It's not as much neurons, there isn't as much wiring going on for parasympathetic. Let's go through this words, and then I'll show you a table that also shows you this, and then I'll show you a picture that shows you this. But in both the, and I gotta be really careful here, here P and S is parasympathetic, and S is sympathetic. I won't do that to you on the test. Okay, PNS up until now has been what? Peripheral nervous system. I won't mess you up on the test. I'll spell it all out. But here, PNS is parasympathetic and SNS is sympathetic. Both of these are going to use myelinated preganglionic axons that are pretty big in diameter. And both of these systems are going to use postganglionic axons that are smaller and unmyelinated. Also, the parasympathetic side is going to have longer preganglionic and shorter postganglionic and have very little branching, whereas the sympathetic side will have shorter preganglionic, longer postganglionic, and have lots and lots of branching. Another way of saying branching would be divergence, lots of neuronal divergence. Let me show you those facts on this picture. On the top, parasympathetic. We're seeing a neuron on the left. That neuron is traveling out of the spinal cord. It's a long preganglionic fiber. It has myelin. What kind of cells are making that myelin? Schwann cells. We're definitely out in the peripheral nervous system. It hits that ganglion, talks to the next neuron. The next neuron is shorter and is unmyelinated. There are no axons, or there's no Schwann cell around it. No, okay. Now remember what that means. I just kind of misspoke. Does unmyelinated mean no Schwann cell? Right? There's still a Schwann cell there, isn't there? But the Schwann cell doesn't wrap around quite the same way. Remember, in an unmyelinated axon, there's still a Schwann cell there protecting it, but it doesn't wrap around, so there's that continuous kind of conduction. Let's compare that top image with the bottom image. That is the sympathetic nervous system. Here we have the neuron leaving the spinal cord. The preganglionic neuron is rather short. It's going out to the ganglion. Notice there's all this branching. Another way of saying branching, there's lots of divergence, right? I told you that the sympathetic system had lots of divergence. And then we come to the ganglion, and then there's a long postganglionic neuron, which is unmyelinated. Let's add one more fact to this slide. We've already talked about it. From what part of the spinal cord is this parasympathetic neuron originating? I told you the parasympathetic originates from a pair of places. Cranium or sacral, right? So this is craniosacral, right? So that neuron cell body would be up in the cranium or down in the sacrum, whereas for the sympathetic, that was thoracolumbar, wasn't it? So that means that that neuron cell body would be originating somewhere from the thoracic or lumbar regions of the spinal cord. One more difference, then we'll look at a table. One more difference is that in the parasympathetic nervous system or the parasympathetic division, the ganglia are what we call terminal ganglia, that means at the end, or they are intramural, meaning that they're actually built into the wall of the organ. Hold on to that thought, and then I'll explain that to you when we see the picture. Here's the table you've been waiting for. And let me tell you how you're going to use this information on Thursday. I'm going to present to you a Venn diagram. So I'm going to give you a Venn diagram. It's going to look like this. Okay. The circle on the left would be for sympathetic. The circle on the right would be for parasympathetic. On the test, I would have it labeled like this, or something like this. Okay? And I would ask a question. Number one, is involuntary? Now, does involuntary refer to sympathetic only, parasympathetic only, both, or neither? Both sympathetic and parasympathetic are involuntary, so that means that it's both, right? So you would bubble in B on the test. If I said to you, number two, if I said voluntary, let's just keep it there. If I said voluntary, you would bubble in D, right? It doesn't apply to either. What if I said originates from a pair of places, cranium and sacral? That's only the parasympathetic, so you would bubble in C, right? Only deals with the parasympathetic nervous system. And what if I said to you, what do we know so far? Is involved with increased awareness of the environment in fight or flight. That would only be sympathetic, and you would type in or bubble in A. Everyone see how that's going to work? So I'm going to ask you some facts about sympathetic versus parasympathetic, and you'll have to plug them into the Venn diagram in their appropriate place. So let's figure out where these facts are going to come from. You're going to go back to this table. Again, this is the second table I have for you. This one is going to compare sympathetic and parasympathetic. On the right, we got sympathetic. On the left, we have parasympathetic. Let's go through this quickly, and I think some things may start, making more sense to you. So what's the function? Well, parasympathetic nervous system was all about conserving energy, rest and digest, whereas sympathetic was all about fight or flight. We got that. Where are the neurons originating? Well, where's that one? Here it is. Where are those neurons originating? Well, for the parasympathetic, it's craniosacral, right? From the cranium, the cranial nerves 3, 7, 9, and 10, and down to the sacral region. Whereas for the sympathetic, it was thoracolumbar. Those cell bodies are originating in the thoracic and lumbar regions. Let me skip down one. Divergence of axons. You know what? Parasympathetic, I told you, was rather simple. It was less wiring involved. There's less branching. Whereas in the sympathetic nervous system, because all points are made alert all at once, there's extensive convergence or divergence, extensive spreading of the signal. I meant to say divergence. I mentioned this fact. In the parasympathetic nervous system, you have very long preganglionic but short postganglionic, and reverse it for the sympathetic. The slide two back, I told you that the ganglia for the parasympathetic were located very close to the organ or even within the organ versus the sympathetic where we have those paravertebral ganglia that we've been looking at before. And we're not going to worry at all about rami. So don't worry about the last factoid at all. Okay. So let's take a look. Parasympathetic. We've already said this. Okay. So I said it a moment ago. If it didn't make sense to you, maybe this will help. Parasympathetic, two places, cranial, sacral. The cranial part's referring to four cranial nerves, 3, 7, 9, and 10. We've already said why those are involved with parasympathetic. 3 was constricting the pupil. 7 and 9 were dealing with saliva and tasting and preparing for digestive meal. And 10 was dealing with the sensations down to not only your gut, but also your intestines and your stomach and everything else related to digestion. Where else do parasympathetic nerves start? We said a pair of places, right? Cranial, we've already said why. 3, 7, 9, and 10 were involved. What organs would you just guess are connected to your sacral nerves? Your sacral nerves way down in the pelvis. What's down there? Bladder, urinary, some gut, some digestive, and reproductive. And that's exactly right. In parasympathetic nervous system, there's more blood flow going to your digestive system, to your urinary system, and to your reproductive systems. During fight or flight, those three systems get negated, right? They lose blood. So it makes sense that those nerves down in the sacral region are actually going to your intestine, going to your bladder, going to your reproductive organs. Okay. Let's take a look at this picture. This picture puts everything in place. Put at the top of this parasympathetic, because it doesn't say it anywhere. This is parasympathetic. Let's study this for a second and figure out what's going on here. Two places along the spinal cord where the nerves are popping off. Cranial, sacral. The nerves that are popping off from the cranium are cranial nerves number 3, 7, 9, and 10. We've been there. We talked about that. 3 was going to the eye for pupil dilation. 7 and 9 were going to the salivary glands for taste. 10, I told you, was going down to the stomach, right? But 10 is also going to your heart. What's it telling the heart? Slow down, relax, enjoy the meal. What's it telling the lungs? Cool it, right? So we see that there's a rheostat. When it comes to the sympathetic nervous system and the parasympathetic nervous system, you're not just sending signals saying to increase activity. You can also send signals that say relax. So we see this balancing act going on. And down here from the sacral region, you see that we have nerves going to the reproductive organs, increasing blood flow there, increasing blood flow to the bladder and to the kidneys, and also to the intestines.
Okay, here's it's on topic, but not necessarily something you need to know. But so when like people tell you to breathe in deep and that kind of thing, if you're stressed out, is there actually like a two-way street with that, where there's a sensory that kind of kicks it into?
There is, and we're going to get to that later in this course about hyperventilating and what it means to blow into a brown bag and keep some of that air and oxygen going back into your body. So hold on to that thought. But yes, there's definitely mechanisms that help control and help relax you by breathing into a bag when you're hyperventilating.
So it's 10 goes to...
10 wanders all the way down. It goes to the gut. kind of senses how digestion's doing, but it also goes to the other viscera. So it's going to help calm down the heart. It's going to help calm down the respiration rate. Okay. I'm oversimplifying this, but that's okay for what we need to understand today. So that's parasympathetic, right? Let's take a look. I think I've already said all this, right? Parasympathetic is involved with processing nutrients, conserving energy. It has less divergence, less spreading. Oops. It has less spreading going on. And it doesn't have mass activation. When I say mass activation, I mean all points bulletin. You know when the twig snaps behind the tent, boom. Heart rate, respiratory rate, mouth goes dry, eyes dilate, all that happens, all or none, all systems go on full alert, mass activation. It's a siren, the whole neighborhood knows it. In the parasympathetic nervous system, because there's less of this divergence and less of this spreading of the signals quickly, you can be more discreet or more localized in the effects. Now, the example I use for this, and it may seem kind of inappropriate, but I think we'll all get the message. This means that for the parasympathetic nervous system, one can digest their meal without being sexually aroused. If we were talking about mass activation, every time we had a meal, parasympathetic, we'd be sexually aroused. Probably not the best idea, right? So we can pick and choose. We can more pinpoint discretion the systems of the parasympathetic nervous system or the effects. Whereas in the sympathetic nervous system, right, it's all or none. Okay, so that's the idea. Parasympathetic system, it's not mass activated. There's more localized discretion of which organs get turned on and which organs do not get turned on.
So it's the body's brake pedal.
It's the body's brake pedal in a way, absolutely. Again, sympathetic nervous system, and we're almost done here, guys. You've done really well. The sympathetic nervous system is more complex. There is more wiring. There is more branching. There is more divergence. And again, this is that all or none response. And these neurons are going to come off your spinal cord from the thoracic and lumbar region, thoracolumbar. We're going to see, again, well, there it is, T to L. Okay, now, I've already said this, but the preganglionic sympathetic axons are very short, whereas the postganglionics are long. You know what? I need to go back for a second and show you something on this image of the parasympathetic nervous system. When you're looking at this picture, I need you to appreciate this. I'm going to draw it in red. The preganglionic axon is very long, and it goes all the way to almost all the way to the effector. And then the ganglion is a little color change right here, right? It's almost at the organ. It is terminal or in the wall of the organ. So the preganglionic fiber is very, very long. The postganglionic fiber, which is shown in blue on these images, is very, very short. Okay, so there's your postganglionic. It's much shorter. Long preganglionic, short postganglionic, and the ganglion is near or at the organ. Versus in the sympathetic nervous system, here it is in words, that the preganglionic neuron is going to be rather short, and the postganglionic neuron will be longer. Let's take a look at that in a picture here in a moment. Okay, so I'm going to jump over to the picture because I think it's going to tell us all that we need to know. Here we go. This is your sympathetic nervous system. This is the last slide. Okay, it pulls everything together. Let's take a look at this for a couple moments. Again, where are the neurons coming off from the spinal cord? Thoracolumbar. The preganglionic neurons are very short because where's the ganglion? These ganglia, the sympathetic chain ganglia, were the paravertebral ganglia, They're right next to the vertebra. So the preganglionic axon only has to travel from the spinal cord to the paravertebral ganglion right next door. Very short. Then the postganglionic axon is much, much longer. Right, so we see the reverse in the length of these axons. Where are these sympathetic neurons going? They're going to the skin. What are they telling the skin? I need more blood. So I'm going to pull blood away from you. You are going to become pale. I'm also going to send a signal to those erector pili muscles so the hairs are going to stand up, right, when you're scared. What else? We're going up to your salivary glands. Huh? What are we going to tell your salivary glands? Dry up, right? I'm scared. I'm going to get cotton mouth. I can't speak. Publicly speaking, I'm scared. My heart rate's going to go up. My respiration rate's going to go up. But I'm going to send a signal to my gut telling it what? Cool it. I'm going to send a signal to my bladder saying, you know what? Not right now. Don't need as much blood flow going to my kidneys right now. And I'm definitely going to shut down reproductive things, right? Nothing scares a moment like a twig snapping behind the tent, okay? So we see that blood flow is shifted very, very quickly, right? And things are moving around here. So does this begin to make sense? The next slide, white rami, nothing from that point on. So what you're going to be doing, and I hope that you heeded my warning. I hope that you spent some good quality time this weekend and that the neuron, the spinal cord, and the brain is making good sense. You're maybe still working on the cranial nerves, and all you're really worried about now is functioning or is learning or focusing on this last little bit on the autonomic nervous system. As you look at this over the next 46 hours, right, you're going to be comparing and contrasting the autonomic nervous system with the somatic motor, and also internally comparing and contrasting sympathetic and parasympathetic. You can do that in words, or you can take these two pictures, right? Maybe pull them up, blow them up, and kind of walk through that table of comparisons and see how those words match up with the comparisons of these pictures. And I think you'll be just fine. On Thursday, all you'll need is a pencil in your Scantron form. It will be the hour and a half exam. And then after that, we'll open up an online test. I've had a couple questions about what's this online test. There will be a take-home exam. It'll be after this exam. You're not worried about it at all. It's open book, open resource, nothing to really stress about. I'll tell you more about that on Thursday. And then don't forget about your short paper, not between now and Thursday, but don't forget about your short paper. That's kind of going on due before Thanksgiving. And I think that's all we need to be worried about right now as far as announcements. Any concerns or things I've forgotten about? Yes, ma'am. Over this,
like the major points.
This exam?
Yeah.
Absolutely. 11, 12, 13, and 14. Mm-hmm. 11 was the chapter on the introduction to the nervous system. I started out by talking about neurons and the different glial cells and the organization of the nervous system. Chapter 12 was everything about the spinal cord. Right, we spent quite a bit of time on the spinal cord, spinal nerves. Chapter 13 was the brain and the cranial nerves. And now we're at the autonomic nervous system, 14. That's not much detail, I know, but those are the chapters involved, right? I will see you all on Thursday. Smile.